Well, good morning. Good morning. Praise the Lord. It's always good to be in the house of the Lord. It's always good to come and praise Him. We was driving this morning, and one of the church signs just said, "Praise the Lord." I thought, that's it. That's what it comes down to. Your life is praising the Lord, thanking Him for what He's done for you. You know, I Friday night I went with our class at DMAC. We went to a night drive, and the thing about taking students out for night, it's a little dip atmosphere, and we went up to Waterloo. Well, I met one of the drivers I used to work with at Walmart, and we worked together for probably 15 years. And one of the things that just struck me Friday night is this particular individual, you know, we got along, but he had a real spirit of complaining about everything. And when I saw him sitting kind of in the corner, he looked so sad, and he's retired, and he was about 10 years older. And I thought, how sad our lives are when we choose to complain. And he brought me some concerns, and I said, you know, you're talking to the wrong person. All I can do is, you know, I can pray about it, but you need to talk to management about those issues, you know, rather than just harbor. And it just struck me that night. I said, Lord, you know, there's more than this life than complaining about the things we don't have. Yeah. We need to flip that around and thank God for what we do have. Yes. You know, there's a whole lot of people that didn't get up this morning.
That's right.
You know, there's a whole lot of people, you know, didn't have the resources to come to church.
Right.
You know, they may have had a desire to come to church. And it just struck me, and said, you know, what we're going to talk about. And one of the things is that we need to always rejoice in the Lord.
Yes.
We
yes.
need to take time to start our day praising God.
Yes.
You know what that does? That puts you in the proper mindset.
Yes,
Pastor talked about, you know, looking out at God and seeing what God can do rather than just looking in the mirror and reflecting on yourself.
Yes.
Like, without God, we can do nothing.
That's right. That's right.
And we got to look at how big our God is. Sometimes we flip things around and think our problems are so big. We need to look and realize that we have a big God. It's not a big thing to Him. You know, He can handle it. You know, we often think that somehow, somewhere, well, God just can't take care of this. Well, I tell you what. Think about the Creator that He created, and He spoke it in existence. Said, this star, you stay there until I tell you otherwise. You know, that's what you got to realize. He said, I'm the deliverer. I'm the healer. Okay, I'm the one that can bless you.
Yes.
I always felt that we could put it in this terms, like that God gets a little frustrated with people who just don't choose to believe Him. That's the difference. It's really funny. We go down Delaware here, and we make a right on University, and the bridge is 13-6. As you go on the railroad bridge. Well, our trailer's 13-6. And so every time we take them under there, they look and says, Tim, can we get under that bridge? We're 13-6, bridge 13-6. I said, I don't know, maybe I'll duck just to make sure. I'll duck down, see if we get under. Said, let me tell you, buddy, I've been in that for 30 years. I think we can go under it one more time. Do you understand? And said, why would I lead you someplace you couldn't fit under? Why would I do that? As an instructor, I wouldn't do that. The thing about God, He says, come, follow me. If you're following somebody, they're walking in front of you.
Exactly.
They've already been there.
Yeah.
That's what I love about God. He don't expect nothing that He wouldn't do Himself.
Amen.
You know, he showed, when Jesus was on earth, He showed what prayer was about.
Yeah.
You know, He had crowds, but He went away with His Father to spend some time to have that connection. You know, and in the garden was always such a powerful place. I still believe that's where the victory was won.
Right.
When He surrendered. Because He said, if there's any other way, can you imagine take every sin, every person, past, present, future, and dump on? I know I've said this before, but this is the best picture. It's like you take a big vat of oil and take a perfectly white cloth and you dump it in there. That's what I think about that sin. Jesus was perfectly white, and to be dumped in there and to be willing. And He said, Father, if this cup can pass me, if there's any other way, but He surrendered. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours. And we got to all come to that point.
Amen.
That's where our lives really change, when we come to that point and we surrender.
Yeah.
We used to sing that song when I was growing up. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. We used to sing that a lot. Yes, Lord. And you know, one of the things the pastor said about the congregation, he said, I surrender all. He said, don't sing it unless you mean it.
Yeah. Right.
Don't just say it. Have thine own way, Lord. You know, we used to sing that song too. Have thine own way, Lord. Don't sing it unless you mean it. Because then that's lying to God. Because God knows your heart.
Yeah.
And in Habakkuk, I love this scripture. Habakkuk 3:17-18. Though the fig tree does not blossom, and there is no fruit on the vines, though the product of the olive fails, and the fields yield no food, though the flock is cut off from the fold, and there are no cattle in the stalls, you know, if all those things happen, if something, things don't seem to go well, I lose my job, this relationship doesn't work, and that doesn't work, you know, my car has 3 flats on it. You know, you have all this stuff just seen happen and happen and happen. If all that stuff happens, that's what Habakkuk understood. Verse 18, yet I will rejoice in the Lord.
Yes,
hallelujah. That's where that victory comes from. That's where it comes from. Yes, I will rejoice in the Lord. I will exult in the victorious God of my salvation. That's where it comes from. You know what God said? I love Romans. We always quote that because it's true. You know, who can separate us from the love of God? If God be for us, who can be against us? That's what we got to realize, that it's time, like they said, and Moses says, who's on the Lord's side? It comes that day, who's on the Lord's side? You know, Jesus was, they was talking, the disciples, Jesus was talking to, who do men say that I am? You know, and then point to Peter, who do you say that I am? And we got to come to that point. Who do you say Jesus is?
Yeah.
He's the Messiah. He's the chosen one.
Yeah.
He's the one that changed my life. And that's what we got to come to.
Amen.
Because everything revolves around that.
Yeah.
Everything.
Yes.
You know, one of the quotes I like, William Carey, missionary, and we've heard this. Expect great things from God. Attempt great things for God. That's what God is looking for, people that will just believe him.
Yeah.
Well, you can't do this. You can't do this. Well, wait, we serve a God that we don't have the can't in the vocabulary.
Amen.
How can we say, oh, with God, the Bible says, for with God, all things are possible.
Yeah.
Does it say some things, a few things? It said all things.
Amen.
Well, I believe when it says all, it means all.
Exactly.
That's what it means.
Exactly.
Do you need a new job or you need some situation? I said, God can get you to a place where the man come out and says, not only do you have that job, we're going to give you 4 weeks vacation to start. How do you like that? Because God is good.
Yes.
We serve a mighty God.
Amen.
You know, and that's where we got to really come to. I think if we get to that point, you know, our problems, all that stuff, you know, we got to look at this way. We got to tell you, one person said, turn our worries into worship. That's where we got to get to. Get from these things. We all have concerns. We all have things that are going on in our life. But if something happens, when you take the time to get on your knees and say, hey, Lord, I need your help.
Amen.
And you know what, Lord? Whatever answer you give me, I know it's the right one because I'm seeking you. I'm not seeking man. You know, I'm not going over here just and borrowing from the bank and doing all this stuff first. I'm seeking you first. The Bible says, seek ye first. It doesn't say second or third or your last resort. And that's what happens sometimes when some Christians, they go to God as a last resort. I said, why are you going to do that? Because God could tell you yes, no, or maybe, or wait a while. That's what we tend to do. A lot of times that happens in relationships. I see that happen, you know, that this seems like a nice person will kind of flow. Rather than say, hey, God, is this the one I should be with? You know, we don't want to do that because he might say no.
Right.
But he's looking down the line. We was talking about it last night. I said, God can see around the curves.
Yeah.
God can see over the mountain.
Yes.
You know, God, we was talking about, just think about, you know, we talk about radar and sonar and all that stuff. Well, God can see clear down at the bottom of the sea, the one who created it. And that's the will we got to come to. It's just start believing God.
Amen.
And see what he can do in our lives.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. 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 We're going to go ahead and open this up because we all got testimonies. We can all testify for what God has done for us. He's blessed us every day, every minute. Yes. testify. Who's first? Come on. Is it? Yes. Absolutely true. You know, Paul planted, Paulus watered, God gave the increase.
Right.
One evangelist said one time, you can never talk to the wrong man about God.
Mm-hmm.
You can never, because you don't know where they're at. And so many people need to hear that. They need to hear that message. Some people you think, man, they seem like they're so far away from God. But you know what? I tell you what, they just, oh, man, I needed to hear that. You're telling me God loves me? Maybe they haven't heard that in their life. You know, we assume sometimes with all evangelists and all that, we assume that people have heard that message. We assume that. They may not have. We assume that people kind of come up through Sunday school. Some may not have. I used to haul furniture, and I was down in Houston, Texas. And at the end of the time I was getting ready to leave, you know, sometimes they'd ask me, do you want anything? You want something to eat or something like that? And usually I was good on that, and I said, well, if it's all right with you, I'd like to pray with the family. And they had a bunch of girls. They think they had three daughters. And the mom, and this was shocking to me. The daughters was like 12, 13, 14, around that area. And she said this, we've never prayed before. Man, I thought, you know, 12, 13, if you got little kids, you're praying all the time. Because they do a lot of stuff, let me tell you. You know, there's a lot of stuff. Lord, be with them.
Yeah.
Like Bob Hope said, they'll never take prayer out of schools as long as they have tests. You know, people are always going to be praying. Help me out. You know, they're always going to be praying. But, you know, it just struck me that you would not tell your kids about the Lord. You would not set that example. I don't mean just, you know, pray for bedtime. People pray. I mean, that's important because you're establishing. But for them to know that they can reach God too. That's what the best gift you can give to your kids. You know, we can give them shoes and clothes and all that stuff, and all that's important. But, you know, to give them the love of the Word of God,
yes.
Give them the love of God, yes. and give them something that can take you into eternity, I mean, that's what's powerful. Give them their own resources that they can pray.
Yes.
That's what will keep them kids, because you may not always be around.
Exactly.
That's what I love about Mom. I could call her up And my Aunt Louise, I called down there and I says, I'll tell Aunt Louise and we pray. And they prayed every morning for years about 5 a.m. And I know it got through. That's one thing I know about them. They would lock arms and they would pray because they took prayer seriously.
Right.
That it did change lives. And I could always count on them. They was dependable. Someone else. Yes, Mark.
I
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Thank the Lord for safe travel for grandkids and kids and even family members here and stuff that are going through the coast and back. And even those that didn't even leave the state, we're in the state traveling around. But I'm not aware of any incidents of any of our family or any of our church family here having any issues. So I praise God for that.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
That's big. That's big. Good. That is awesome, because it's to move from complaining to proclaiming God's goodness. That's a big step, and that's what we got to become, proclaiming what God can do, what he's already done, and what he will do, because he'll come through. He'll come through. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Someone else.
Yeah, the Lord.
Praise,
praise
the Lord.
Lord.
Praise the Lord. God knows where it's at.
Yes, he does.
God knows where it's at. Yeah. Okay. Anybody else? Well, what I'd like to do, Sheila, if you come up here, we're going to anoint this cloth for your friend. And if y'all gather up front, we're going to pray, and we're going to anoint this. If y'all wouldn't mind coming up.
Father God, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. In the name of Jesus, we're going to greet.
Thank you all for coming up and praying. That's what the church does right there. We pray one for another. When we come together in agreement, you know, behold how good is brethren to dwell together in unity. You have that outpouring of God just flowing through this place. And we're going to go and today after service, everybody, right? Mexican dinner today.
Yeah.
You know, after service, come join us. Okay, and we're going to speak the word of God.
Yes.
That's how powerful. Speak his word. Okay.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created to function, and I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed, renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right. Need a couple. Brother, would you come up for take the offering for me, please? Yep, if you wouldn't mind, come up. I appreciate it. Thank you, Jason. Thank you, brother. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you.
Time to get our praise on, church. Hallelujah.
The flame, keep it alive, even a blaze on the inside. Come have your way, rise in this place, consume our hearts for your name's sake. Come receive Holy Spirit from above, Holy Spirit. Fall upon us, breathe on us, Holy Spirit from above, Holy Spirit, fall upon us. Look on their threats, stretch out your hand, come and shake this place. Give us boldness,
yes,
we lift up our voice, as one we will shout, your kingdom come, your will be done. Come receive Holy Spirit from above, Holy Spirit fall upon us. Come on. let your fire fall. We are in need of you. Our hearts are longing for your presence. Lord, let your fire fall. We are in need of you. Our hearts are longing for your presence. Lord, let your fire fall. We are in need of you. Our hearts are longing for your presence. Lord, let your fire fall. We are in need of you. Our hearts are longing for your presence. Come receive, Holy
again, Lord. Oh, thou Christ, the burning, cleansing flame, send the fire, the blood-bought gift, today we claim, send the fire today. Down and see this waiting host. Give us the promised Holy Ghost. We want another Pentecost. Send the fire today. Send. Yes, Lord. Send it again, Lord. We need your touch, oh Lord. Yes, Lord. Oh, God of Elijah, hear our cry.
Send the fire.
He'll make us fit to live or die.
Send the fire today to burn up every trace of sin, to bring the light and the glory. Send the fire today. Send the fire. Send the fire.
Yesterday I heard something from Brother Ray Hughes, Salem Ministries. Pastor reminds me a lot of him. Really gifted in the prophetic things. I love this song. Keep playing. I love this song. It shows what God did in the past. But God has promises for today and tomorrow.
Yes.
And Ray quote, I'm paraphrasing his quote, but he says, honor the past, but pursue the promises that he has for the present and for the future. We need to pursue those promises now, not wait for them to come, because the kingdom is within us. The fire is within us.
Yes.
Okay? We need to release that fire. We need to learn to release that fire. The passion that the Lord has had for us, he put within us to have us to take and reach out to a dying world, that we need to touch them, that we need to release God's kingdom on them, that his kingdom would be furthered. We have been empowered. Let us start walking it in Jesus' name.
Cause it's fire we want, for fire we bleed. Send the fire. The fire will meet our every need. So send the fire today for strength. Grace to conquer in the fight, for power to walk the world in white. Send the fire today, send the fire, send the fire, send the fire, send the fire today.
It's within your spirit. It's within your kingdom. That's God within you. You send that fire out. You send it out.
Send the fire today. So send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire today.
The fire that's within you, send it out today, today, right now, in Jesus' holy name.
Overcome. I have overcome. I have
acoustic. They overcame.
They overcame by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony.
Yes, Lord.
They love not their lives unto death. Therefore rejoice for heaven's sake.
Yes, Lord.
In this world you shall have tribulation. Therefore be of good cheer. I have overcome.
Yes, I have.
I have overcome.
Yes, Lord.
I have overcome the world. I have overcome. I have overcome. I have overcome. They overcame by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. They love not their lives unto death. Therefore rejoice, for heaven sees.
Yes, I see. Yes, Lord.
Therefore be of good cheer. I have overcome.
Have you come over?
I have overcome. I have overcome the world.
Yes, I have.
I have overcome. I have overcome.
Jesus, you went into the garden.
Yes, Lord.
You want to take it on. You want to put the end of this thing, Lord, that curse, to put the end of it, Lord.
Hallelujah.
You put the end of this curse, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
You set it up, Lord.
Jesus.
You set it up before the foundations of the earth, Lord. Immediately when Adam and Eve sinned, immediately Calvary was set into place. It was downloaded. It was running. was on. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned, unclean.
Wonderful, and my song shall end.
awesome, Lord. You gave it all, Lord. Loved us first. Let your kingdom reign and rule, Lord.
Yes, Lord, that every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess the name of Jesus Christ, name above all names, that you are worthy, Lamb who was slain, Alpha, Omega, beginning and end, Creator God, more than a friend, closer than a brother.
Thank you.
God. Let's lift our hands to the Lord. We bless your name. We worship you this morning, Lord. You alone are worthy. We praise you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege to be able to come into your presence corporately, Lord, to worship you, to lift you up, to magnify you. For you are great and greatly to be praised, Lord. There's none like you. You alone, Lord, are God. And we praise you and worship you, Lord. And everybody said, in Jesus' name, praise God. God bless you. You may be seated. Sunday school kids, go downstairs. Hallelujah. Thank you, Tim. Worship team, appreciate it. God bless all of you. And all of you have come. Praise the Lord. Stick around afterwards. Maybe I should say, stick around afterwards, pour for four, right? Praise God. Hallelujah. That's about it. Praise that. And uno cerveza, please. Por favor. I'm getting to the end of my Spanish right now. Como se llama. I had the como se llama knocked out of me one time in Tijuana. Praise the Lord. Now, God is good. Amen. All the time. Praise the Lord. Appreciate everybody being here again. And I want to get right to the word this morning. And so if you will, Sheila, we're going to start in the Gospel of John, chapter 12, and I want to read verse 21 to begin with. And just let me preface this by saying that, you know, we know that the law came by Moses, and grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. In fact, grace is the person of Christ. And so another way to say that, and I'll get into this more as I go along this morning, is that the difference between the law and grace, multiple differences, but the one I want to focus on is that the law is two-dimensional, and Jesus is three-dimensional. And the reason for that is Jesus has personality, and the law has no personality outside of Christ unless we look at it through grace, unless we look at it through Christ, we're only seeing a two-dimensional thing, and it would be wise, I think, of all of us to kind of meditate on these things a little bit, and that's what I want to do is give you some things to think about this morning. I'm not trying to be controversial for the sake of doing it, but I'm sure it probably will be considered that way by some. But I'm anti-religious. Amen. And that means I'm anti all religious settings. So not just the ones I don't agree with, amen, not just the ones I haven't been a part of, or not just the ones that I have been a part of and then left, but all of them. Praise the Lord. And I'll try to make more sense out of that as we go. But in John chapter 12, verse 21, praise God. The same came therefore to Philip, which was of Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. Or, in other words, in our common vernacular, they said, we'd like to see Jesus. We'd like to see him. That's our plan. We want to come into contact with him, right? So if you will, Sheila, we'll drop down to verse 42, the same chapter, and we'll read 42 through 50. John 12, 42 through 50. Get us a place to start here. Hallelujah. Nevertheless, among the chief rulers also many believed on him, but because of the Pharisees they did not confess him, lest they should be put out of the synagogue, for they loved the praise of men more than the praise of God. Jesus cried and said, He that believeth on me believeth not on me, but on him that sent me. And he that seeth me seeth him that sent me. I am come a light into the world, that whosoever believeth on me should not abide in darkness. And if any man hear my words and believe not, I judge him not, for I came not to judge the world, but to save the world. He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him, the word that I have spoken. The same shall judge him in the last day. For I have not spoken of myself, but the Father which sent me, he gave me a commandment, what I should say and what I should speak. And I know that his commandment is life everlasting. Whatsoever I speak, therefore, even as the Father said unto me, so I speak. Praise the Lord. Amen. So I want you to keep this in mind, amen, that if you really want to know Jesus, not about Jesus, not through some religious system, but if you really want to know him, because it is true, this is about a personal relationship with Jesus, no matter how cliche that might have become over the years. This is about a personal relationship with Jesus. Amen? And so to come to know Jesus intimately, not religiously, not vicariously somehow, through somebody else's words or somebody else's experience, but to know him intimately as he is. And that's the key, as he is, as he wants to be known, is to release a redemptive landslide in our lives. It'll change everything. It will change everything that we've experienced and everything that God wants us to experience of him. Praise the Lord. So, again, law is information. Grace is a person. Praise God. So let's go to Mark chapter 3, and we'll read verses 1 through 6. Mark 3, 1 through 6. And he entered again into the synagogue, and there was a man there which had a withered hand. And they watched him, whether he would heal him on the Sabbath day, that they might accuse him. And he saith unto the man which had the withered hand, stand forth. And he saith unto them, is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath days or to do evil, to save life or to kill? But they held their peace. And when he had looked round about on them with anger, being grieved for the hardness of their hearts, he saith unto the man, stretch forth thine hand. And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored whole as the other. And the Pharisees went forth and straightway took counsel with the Herodians against him, how they might destroy him. Praise God. So let me ask you a rhetorical question here. Do you believe that the devil is simply going to let that redemptive landslide that I spoke of a moment ago happen? He's just going to back off and say, have at it. Amen? Satan's most effective, most powerful work are works of deception. So he deceives us by presenting a distorted Christ. And he does that through religion. It's obvious these people didn't know Jesus. And yet they had all the scriptures. And he tells them in another place, you search the scriptures, for in them you think you'll find eternal life, and they are speaking about me. And yet you won't come to me. You want to kill me. Amen? So Jesus heals this guy's hand on the Sabbath, and his enemies decide to kill him. Religion. You really think that's over with? Why would that have ended with the time of Jesus? If God's the same yesterday, today, and forever, I can promise you the devil's doing the same stuff today that he was doing 2,000 years ago, too. I know he is. I know he's been doing it for 68 years in my life, the same stuff, because he figures out how to use it, how to make it work. Praise God. We can still fall under the same religious deception, under that religious veil, as Christians, as Pentecostals, as Charismatics, as just pick a denomination, and we can still be tricked. We can still be deceived. Praise God. 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. Sheila? Oh my God. Jesus. I see you. Praise the Lord. Little freak out there for me. Praise God. I know it's Roberto, but I had to do a double take there. Praise the Lord. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. And let me just say this. prophecy is not necessarily, thus saith the Lord. I see, you know, a white horse in your future and a, you know, a dark cloud is coming and all that. No, prophecy, I prophesy all the time, and I guarantee you, so do you. You just don't know it because it doesn't sound religious. You're just speaking in agreement with the Word of God, which is prophecy. This is the spirit of prophecy, Jesus Christ, the Word of God, made flesh. He is the spirit of prophecy. And you don't have to get all mumbo-jumbo and get all flaky and draw attention to yourself. Prophesy. You speak what the Spirit speaks to you through you. Sheila was talking about it this morning. Several of you talked. Tim was talking about it. Myron was talking about it. Prophecy is God speaking through somebody. It isn't just necessarily telling the future, although sometimes that happens. But we've turned it into a religious thing. As surely as the Jews turned their religious rituals and so forth into a religious kind of churchy thing and didn't even see Jesus in the middle of it. And while we're talking about it, I can get on this, beat this dead horse forever, but because I've been through this, okay? I didn't just come down with the last shower or fall off a turnip truck or whatever metaphor you want to use. And I can tell you that Jesus didn't go through a big ritual to heal this guy.
Right. Amen.
He didn't say, look at me, here's what I'm going to do. I got the power. I'm going to make some great, significant thing happen here, and I want everybody's eyes on me because I'm planning on starting a ministry after this. He just said, stretch out your hand. The guy stretched out his hand, and he was healed. He spoke to him like one human being to another human being, not like some ethereal, unworldly person to some earthly person. Praise the Lord. Well, that was free. So the prophets are gone out. He says, but try the spirits, whether they be of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come, and even now is, or has come. Drop down to verse 6, if you will. We are of God, and he that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Praise the Lord. Spirit of truth is the Holy Spirit. Spirit of God, it's the spirit of Christ that resides in each one of us as believers. The spirit of falsehood or the spirit of error is the spirit of Antichrist. It's that simple. He doesn't have 20 horns sticking out of his head and come running down the street at you with a pitchfork. You're not going to know it except that it's error. It's not, it doesn't agree with the Word of God. That's Antichrist. Amen? It isn't just some bad guy that shows up at the end of the world. It's a spirit. And it was in the world then. When Jesus was in the world, it was there. And it has still here. It hadn't gone. It hasn't left. Praise the Lord. So, Antichrist spirit presents a distorted image of Christ. That's its job. That's his goal. Otherwise, he wouldn't be Antichrist, would he?
Right.
He'd be Christian. He's Antichrist because he tries to pervert the image of Jesus. He tries to distort the person of Christ. And again, let me make this clear. We're talking about a spirit, not necessarily a human being. That may happen in the end days where the Antichrist will be completely filled with the spirit of Satan. But now, it's a spirit that operates, and let me say this, it operates in the church half the time. In religion, I'm talking about. The spirit of falsehood is a very religious spirit. If you don't believe that it is, then you need to go back and read what Jesus is saying to these Pharisees that were the most religious people that ever walked the planet. And he said, you're sons of the devil. You're not of God because you're rejecting God. Praise the Lord. Well, that spirit still exists today. The spirit of falsehood. We don't need to be scared of it. I'm not talking about being frightened, and I'm not trying to freak anybody out. I'm just trying to open our eyes up. And let's be real, okay? Let's just be real about who we are, and what we've got, and deal with it from there. And stop the mumbo-jumbo and the hocus-pocus and get down to what it is we really do, who we really are, and what we're capable of in Christ. I heard it this morning. Say, well, what's the big deal? I'll tell you the big deal. Sheila is operating in the Spirit. God is functioning through her. Myron is being used by the Spirit of God. Tim is being used by the Spirit of God. And I would venture to say, if I stop and talk to every one of you, because I do talk to you, he's doing the same thing with all of you. Every time you get a chance to talk to somebody and share with somebody one-on-one, as one person to another person, one human being to another human being, the Spirit of God operates through you to that person.
Right.
You don't have to have clouds of smoke and organ music in the background for that to be a reality. It is a reality, because Jesus didn't have any organ music in the background, and there weren't puffs of smoke coming around him either. He was just simply God in the form of man, operating as a man, interacting with other men. And other women.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Let's take the mystery out of this. Religion has made it more mysterious. It's not supposed to be mysterious. It's supposed to be simple enough that a little child can get it.
Exactly.
Say, well, confess with your mouth. I'm telling you, I had a conversation with a woman yesterday. I'm telling you, you don't want some of these conversations, because they don't go away.
Right.
They stay in your head. Like pictures being rolled over and over and over. You ever had somebody tell you a really horrible story about their life or their situation or their circumstance? It doesn't go away. It gets etched into your gray matter, and you see it. And it wasn't your experience, but you still got it, praise the Lord. And I'm not complaining. I'm just saying it happens. It happens to all of us, because anytime we open ourselves up to somebody to talk or to let them kind of unload, you get their stuff too. That's why Jesus was going away a lot of times. It wasn't because he was tired of sharing the truth of God. He was worn out with everybody else's stuff. Praise the Lord. This is not about me. I'm just saying, he was a human being. He wasn't, I said this Wednesday night, you know, we think of God in the flesh. And we think, okay, it's God pretending to be a man. You know, it's like, because he can do anything. But no, he made himself a human. He limited himself to what a human being can do. He wasn't like Einstein pretending to only know, you know, long addition with all of his genius. No, he was a human. He had to be born, he had the messy diapers, he had to nurse, he had to grow up, he had to grow in stature as well as in spirit. He had to learn stuff just like everybody else. He hurt, he cried, he laughed, he grieved. Everything we experience, he experienced without sin. That's the only difference. And let me say this, I'm getting ahead of myself, but I'm just here now, so praise the Lord. God chose to come as a man. The eternal, almighty, imperceptible, omniscient, omnipresent God chose to humble himself and literally become a man. Not pretend to be a man and still be God that can change anything I want to if I need to. Amen? He became a human being. Totally limited to what a human being can do with faith in God.
Amen.
And the Bible tells me that we are created in God's image. God's image, you can debate this and argue it and call me a fool for saying it, but God's image is human. I'm not saying that God is a human. But I'm saying God has the same kinds of emotions and feelings that humans have. or we could not have been created in his image. Everybody says, well, we were created spirits because God is a spirit. Then if God wanted to reveal himself, why didn't he reveal himself as a spirit instead of as a man? Because a man more closely identifies with who and what God is and how God relates. I'm not diminishing God. Don't misunderstand me. I know I'm not always the best at explaining myself or expressing myself, but I'm not saying God is a man, but I'm saying God created us, men and women, out of him. So yes, we are spirit beings, but we're going to be men and women for eternity. Just as Jesus is right now, seated at the right hand of God. So I would say this. If I take this premise and just extrapolate, just go further with it, I would say then it only makes sense to me that we would relate to one another as humans rather than spirits. I'm not saying we shouldn't be led by the Spirit, the Spirit doesn't have a function in our life, but the function is to get us to operate at the highest level possible for human beings. Right. Not to pretend that we are some unearthly body. If that were the case, why didn't he just take us out of here when we got born again? Why? Because this planet is inhabited by humans. And if we're going to relate to other human beings that are unsaved, we got to relate to them as humans. Amen. Not like we're some kind of flake from another planet.
There you go.
Amen. Well, praise God. See, that religious spirit still operates. It's like the flu. It morphs itself. It adapts itself to every... Once you get... There's an inoculation for it, right? Yep. 2 years later, you got to get a different flu shot because the flu has morphed itself or adapted itself to another environment.
Right.
Now you can get it again. You had the shot, but now you're going to get it again. You're going to get something else, another kind of flu. But it's still the flu, right?
Right.
That's what this spirit of religion, of falseness, does. With every revelation that comes, and we've seen it even in our own lifetimes. You get a revelation, the first thing the enemy wants to do is come and distort it.
Right.
Pervert it. Because every revelation is a revelation of God. Every true revelation of the Bible is a greater understanding of God, a greater revelation of God. And so if the enemy's job is to pervert the image of Jesus, then every time we get another picture or better image or a clearer image of Jesus or of God, then the enemy's going to come in and try to twist that. Try to pervert it so it isn't the pure picture that God wants us to see of himself. Praise God. So, I'm just saying, Pentecostals come along thousands of years after. I'm saying Pentecost was Pentecost. It was a real deal.
Yep.
But, 1,800 years later, 1,900 years later, when Pentecost began to open up again, and I'm not even going into all the other revelations, back to Martin Luther and all the others that came up through Calvin and all the people, in the past. I'm just focusing on these because this is closer to where we are today. And what happened? The Holy Spirit was being poured out again, and people began to speak in other tongues and did a whole bunch of other stuff that I don't find in the Bible. Praise the Lord. I'm not saying it's sin. I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm saying it's people responding to a revelation of God in a uncompletely, not particularly perfectly true way. You get what I'm saying? I mean, I shout, okay? I'm not against that. And I'll jump up and down. I get excited. I'm not saying don't do that. I'm not saying that isn't right. But you're not going to do that on the job. Right? We do this in a corporate worship environment just like they've always done it, like David did.
Right.
We're showing the Lord. We are in love with you. We praise you. We worship you. But I don't act like that anywhere else. And I guarantee you don't either, right? Because you'll be arrested. Praise the Lord. Or at least be under, supervision. I mean, I do stuff here. I don't do when I go to the dry cleaners. I talk about Jesus at the dry cleaners. I talk about Jesus just like I'm talking with you right now. Just like one human being to another human being. I don't buck. You know, I don't freak out. It's just as true. But I talk about him just like I would talk about anything else, except that it's Jesus. Because I promise you, the guy that does my dry cleaning would not take kindly to me across his counter. And I'd be careful about what was in the collars of my shirts after that. Amen. Because he can't relate to that. He can relate to Jesus if I present Jesus honestly. Huh? Uncorrupted by my religious thing. In fact, he has me come and pray for his employees. But I don't get all flaky and freaky when I'm doing that either. I lay hands on them and I pray in Jesus' name. Right? They can relate to that. Because we were created to relate to one another as human beings. That's why God came in the flesh, so that we could relate to him, so that we could see that God is not just some far-off, distant, ethereal, you know, undisconnected somehow being, but he is touched with the feelings of our infirmities. He knows what it's like to be a human, and he says it's okay. Operate like a human. That's how I created you.
Come on.
Just be led by the Spirit. Look at Jesus' life. I'm not making this up, and I'm not saying this to aggravate anybody or to irritate anybody. I'm saying, look, let's look at what Jesus did. Not what charismatics do today, not what Pentecostals are doing today. What did Jesus do? He talked to them like they were people. He interacted with them as though they were just another person like him. The only difference was he knew something they didn't know. And his whole purpose was to impart that which he knew to them who didn't know it. So they could enjoy the same reality as him. That's our mission. That's our job. That's what we do. We just be. It may sound too simple, but it's just the way it is. If we're Christians, we'll just be Christians. And God will give you plenty of opportunity to allow the Holy Spirit to minister through you as one human to another. Praise God. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. Look how difficult the Pharisees made knowing God or interacting with God. It was difficult enough as it was, but they did have a sacrifice so that they could have communion or relationship with God on a limited level. But they weren't content with that. They just put all kinds of other stuff on there because they wanted it to be all about them. When Jesus comes along and says, this is how simple it is, just reach out your hand. Just come and I'll be with you. They didn't want that because it was taking away their position of esteem. It limited them to being no better than everybody else. God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the world, who being the brightness of his glory, and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of God. The true knowledge, majesty on high, praise the Lord. True knowledge of Jesus is the greatest need that anybody and everybody has. True knowledge of Jesus. To be deceived about the nature of Jesus, believing a distortion of Jesus, is the worst possible mistake a person can make. Because it'll mess your life up forever. So think about this. What comes to your mind when you think of Jesus? A question I ask people all the time. Is he near or is he far? Is he close? Is he in you? Or distant and uninterested in your human experience? Is he only interested in heavenly issues and weirdness? Or does he actually care about you in your humanity? Does he have a sense of humor? I know he does. Praise the Lord. Every time I look in the mirror, every time I have a day like yesterday, he's God. Come in, guys, blocking the parking, you can't get in, and being my spiritual, high-minded self that I am. When he got the mail, asked him to move the vehicle because we got a number, and some other people were coming, and there wasn't room. Now that I was parked, there wasn't going to be room for another vehicle to get between his and mine. And, of course, he blew me off, like is often the case when it comes to people using our parking for their own purposes. And by the time I got back from the mailbox, I was in the flesh, praise the Lord, if I hadn't already been. I said, get the car out of the driveway. Well, we're looking at a truck over here. I said, then park in his driveway and look at his truck. And then he started saying a bunch of stuff that I can't repeat, although I'd thought about saying it right back at him. Praise the Lord, because I can. But I'm human. I'm not proud of my humanity all the time. I'm not particularly, you know, I'm not suggesting you want to lose your cool every once in a while either, but I know you already do anyhow. You just might not speak it out. But we've talked about this before. The thought's bad is the act as far as God's concerned. So that doesn't mean I should just go ahead and blow off just because I know he already knows I want to, but I'm just saying, we are human beings. Let's be humans. Let's try to be the best humans we can be. The only way to do that is by staying focused on him, his level of humanity, the place he took humanity to and wants to continue to take us to. Amen? So at sundry times and divers manner spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the world, who being the brightness of his glory, we're talking about Jesus now, and how he reveals God, the brightness of his glory, and the express image of his person. That tells me this. God is a person, even though he's not the person that we think or the way we see a person. But his inner being, who he is, has personality. He didn't just make one up for Jesus. That is his personality. So just because he doesn't have a bodily form, I'm talking about the Ancient of Days, outside of Christ, he is a person. He thinks like a person. He interacts like a person, only spotless, without sin, perfect, righteous, holy, eternal. Otherwise, he wouldn't have created us like this. He created us like this because he wanted fellowship. If I wanted fellowship, I wouldn't have brought a dog out of me. Because I can pat the dog on the head and he can wet on my carpet, but he can't really be my pal. He can't really be my friend. I can befriend him, but he'll never be able to be my friend because we can't relate to one another. We can't communicate with each other because my dog's personality doesn't fit any kind of personality that I can deal with. If we're not like God personality-wise, then we're just two-dimensional beings.
Right.
Amen. Okay, so hath in these last days spoken, who being the brightness of his glory, the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Praise the Lord. So, what words would you use to describe Jesus? Without a personality, whatever you're describing is going to be two-dimensional. and nobody can relate to it. It's like trying to love a greeting card. The only reason that greeting card or a get well card means anything at all is because you know the person behind it. You know a personality behind the card. If it's just the card, I go through cards looking for Mother's Day, birthdays, get well, whatever, sympathy cards, and I'm they all say nice stuff, but you're looking and you're trying to find the one that fits the personality of the person that you're going to give it to, and they'll be able to relate to the personality of the person that sent it, because otherwise it's just some letters on a page. Praise God. That's why somebody that hates you gives you a card. You know what? It's not that impressive. Yeah. You go, yeah, well, it was, I know where that's coming from. Right. It's personality. Think about it. It's personality that distinguishes a good novel from a phone book. Uh-huh. They're both full of words. But only one of them is worth reading. Personality is what makes the difference between a great song and elevator music. They're both just all kinds of notes, but one, you got to be trapped in a place to hear it. And the other, you go out and buy the CD, or the record or the whatever. Why? Because there's a personality, there's something you relate to. It's not just some bland background stuff. It's something that you connect with. And that's what I'm saying. When we present Jesus in a religious way, we're taking the personality out of Jesus, and it's no wonder that people can't relate. Right. We're making him some, weird, far-off, strange thing, because we're acting weird and far-off and strange, and they think that must be what Jesus is. No, he created us in his image so that we would function in that image, so that we would operate like sane people, amen, with a beautiful story to share.
Yes. Come on.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Personality is what makes someone someone and not everyone or anyone. Just think about your day. You go through the day and you see all kinds of people. You don't know them, you don't interact with them, and you don't really care if you do, right? They're two-dimensional. That's why you don't care. They have no personality as far as you're concerned. There's no way for you to connect with them. They're just out there. It's personality that makes everything worthwhile. You can know, say, a person from a foreign country, and you maybe you already have an image or an attitude about that country because some bad stuff has happened against the United States or against your family or against personal, whatever. And so you can despise that. But if you get to know somebody from that country, and you begin to understand their personality, you begin to enter, all of a sudden you have to start reevaluating all of these preconceived ideas and thoughts and attitudes about that person or that group of people. Exactly. And it's easy to do when they're two-dimensional because you can just write them off. But get to know them. Yeah. They become three-dimensional. And now all of a sudden, they're just like you. Yeah. You can relate to them. You can connect with them. You can interact with them. You can feel their pain. You can understand their kind of situations and their circumstances to some degree where you never could before. That's why Jesus said this has to be a personal relationship. And that's why he tells us, I am the exact image of God. I'm approachable. I'm real. I understand. I'm not freaked out by your humanity. You can relate to humans. Relate to me. I came as a human being so that we can relate. So that we can have this closeness. You lose Jesus' personality and you lose Jesus. And what you're left with is religion. God
is personality. And he gave us his nature. That's what differentiates us from every other species on the planet. Personality. My dog is two-dimensional. I'm three-dimensional because of personality. Now, that is sometimes questioned. I usually don't have personality until after two cups of coffee. But I'm just saying, the thing that makes us different is that we were created in the image of God, and that difference is personality. Now, I'm not saying that eliminates this being born again, the spirit and everything else. I'm just saying, fundamentally, God loves the world because they are created in his image even though they're not born again. It's like the difference between family and strangers. Why is it that we can put up with the goofiness and the weirdness of our family members? Because we know their personality. If somebody else acted the way I've acted at times to my brothers, they'd punch them out. Cuss them out or something. Right?
Yep.
And vice versa. And the reason we don't is because I know them.
Yep.
I know their personality. I can forgive their idiosyncrasies and their weirdness because they're family.
Yep.
This is the fundamental thing that God's doing. I'm not trying to minimize it or dumb it down to something, you know, psychological, but I'm saying that's what's behind this. God relates to us, and he wants us to relate to him the same way.
Amen.
So that we can, because I'm telling you, it's really hard to relate to Almighty God. Now, I can worship him. Amen. I can be humbled before him, and I am. Whenever I think of it, that's what corporate worship's about. That's what all this is about. But he doesn't want us to live there. He wants us to live in a relationship with him.
Yes.
And he has to be approachable to do that. And that's why he came as Jesus. And what I'm saying is what we do in religion is we mess with that. And we get so spiritual that people are freaked by it. When Jesus never did it, why did we do it? I'll give you my theory. It's because we want to be perceived as being more spiritual. Jesus never did. He was quite secure in his spirituality. And so should we be if we really want to be used. Because you can have all of that stuff but never be able to approach another human being because of it. Unless it's somebody in your group. What's missing in our typical Bible reading and in our efforts to read what Jesus is saying and doing in our personal lives on a day-to-day basis is that his personality is veiled by religion. So we just don't think that he's that approachable. There has to be a ritualistic way of doing this. How do you feel about people that are serious all the time? I mean, are they fun to hang out with? Grim, serious, right? And you got to be serious too, or you can't be around them for very long.
Right.
Laughter is from God. Now, I can tell you, early on in my ministry, I'd tell jokes and stuff and just kind of joke around. And I'm telling you, I got some blowback because I was in a holiness church. I mean, they may not all have been like that, but the ones I was in, they really didn't take kindly to it.
Right.
Humor was for someplace else. Not in the church. This is serious business. It is serious business. God's serious, but he has a sense of humor.
Yes, right.
Praise the Lord. Laughter's from God. I said laughter is from God.
Right.
And that truth alone might save us from a lot of religious veiling that takes place. It tries to cloud our perception of God as being stern and always on the throne of judgment. We've already been judged in Jesus. We ought to be happy. We ought to be the happiest people on the planet. And we ought to be sharing that kind of joy with other people. And you can have the same thing. Genesis chapter 17, verse 19, Roberto. I'll try to talk faster. But I really think this is important stuff. This is stuff that I Yeah, I've been dealing with this for years. I'm not trying to offend anybody or mess with your rice bowl, you know, or your particular way of ministering. That's your business. I'm just saying what I have learned is that I don't have to go around with a big sign on me saying, hey, I'm spiritual. I just am spiritual. And I don't need to prove it to anybody.
Exactly.
It's just a fact. I can't be born again and not be. The reason we do things the way we do things here is to empower everybody. Not that you don't have the power, but so that you know that you have the ability to do the same works as Jesus. And greater works than those will you do if you believe. So the only problem is not whether you have the ability. The problem is whether you believe that you have the ability or not. Which is why we do things the way we do it here. So that everybody feels like, hey, I'm not number three on the list of power here. Everybody's equal. We all got the same Jesus. We all got the same Holy Ghost. We all got the same anointing. It's just a question of whether or not you recognize that and are willing to step out in faith and use it. The difference between the person that's being used and you is that you're not stepping out in faith.
Come on.
It's the only difference. If you're a believer, it's the only difference there can be.
Right.
If all the fullness of the Godhead dwelt in him and we are in him, stands to reason we got everything that comes with it. So the job of the church, or at least the job of a pastor, is to equip or to enable the people that he teaches to do what the Bible says they're capable of doing. And that's all I'm doing. I don't claim some great, you know, worldwide, you know, evangelism ministry or something. It's just what anybody would do based on what the Word of God says.
Amen.
Now, we all got different ways of doing that and you know, presenting it. So that's what makes us unique. And that's why God doesn't cookie cutter all of us so that we're identical. There ought to be some uniqueness to each of us. Because we're all different people. Even though we all have personalities, we have different kinds of personalities that some relate to others more than others.
Yes.
Praise God. So God said, Sarah, thy wife shall bear thee a son indeed, and thou shalt call his name Isaac. And I'll establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant and with his seed after him. So notice this. God says to Sarah, thy wife, speaking to Abraham, Sarah, your wife is going to bear a son indeed. Now, they're like 100 and something and 90 something.
Right.
And the scripture says that Sarah laughed. She was in the tent. And later, Abraham laughs too. What does God name Isaac? Isaac means Abraham, or Abraham. Isaac means laughter.
Right.
You can look it up in any concordance. That's what Isaac means, laughter. And God named him.
Yep.
Why? Because he found it funny too.
Yep.
He found it comical, you know. And so comical, the whole setting, that he names Isaac, the result of this thing, laughter.
Yeah.
Now, you could say, well, they were laughing because they couldn't believe it. Yeah, they were laughing because it seemed unrealistic, but at the same time, they were laughing at the very possibility of it.
Yeah.
Imagine.
Yeah.
If you turn up pregnant, there's going to be some laughing. Now, it may not be from you.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. You know? Or my wife. There'll be some laughing. I promise you there'll be some laughter. It probably wouldn't be from Sally. Right? But I'm telling you, the family would get a kick out of it for sure. Praise the Lord. And that's what God is implying here. Laughter comes from God. He names this kid laughter. He sees this as a funny situation. Yeah, it's very serious at the same time because through Abraham's lineage is going to come the Christ, but it's still comical. God's got a sense of humor. Praise the Lord. God seals that humor with the name that he picks for their son, Isaac. Jesus created laughter. Look at this. 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. 1 John 1, 1 through 3. I want us to be real. I want us to be Christians. But I want us to be real, approachable, effective Christians.
Yes.
Let's just be us. You got a personality, I got a personality. All God's children got personalities. Amen? Why? Because your personality will connect with some people, amen, in a way that mine won't. Jesus' personality connected with everybody. But unfortunately, we're not quite that good at it. But your personality is what sells you to people.
Yes, it is.
Come
not your knowledge, isn't your good looks or your big hair. Praise the Lord. Your long dress or your ways of ministering, personality. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, and which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled to the word of life. For the life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness. This is the disciples talking. Witness, and show unto you that eternal life, which was with the Father, and was manifested unto us. That which we have seen and heard, declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father, and with his Son, Jesus Christ. They're saying, we saw the personality. We interacted with this two-dimensional individual that became three-dimensional. A two-dimensional God who is off and distant that nobody could quite reach or contact or interact with has become three-dimensional. Yes. And we interacted personality-wise back and forth with him. We seen him. We talked to him. We enjoyed his company. We saw him as a human being. We experienced him as a human.
Yes.
Now, how is that going to happen on this planet unless the church is willing to be human and interact with other humans? If it was important enough for God to do that in order to reach us, don't you think that we ought to be doing the same thing? Instead of trying to elevate ourselves to some great spiritual height, maybe we ought to be more interested in being as human as possible and just sharing the truth. I'm not saying there isn't a time for the spiritual activity, but it's more about when we come together as believers, we operate there because we can relate. Praise the Lord. Some people think that keeping Jesus, you know, mysterious and heavenly is proper. I don't. When he came completely as a human, a person, a man with a very distinct personality. And that's the primary witness that we have of him. That's how God chose to make himself known. And we were created in that image. This is the self that he presents to us. Don't push him away with religious stuff. Be real.
Yep.
Be human.
Yep.
He's approaching you as a human.
Come on.
Jesus resurrected is still Jesus, a man.
Mm-hmm.
Flesh and bone. And a personality as well. Mark chapter 7. Verses 6 through 9. He answered and said unto them, well hath Isaiah prophesied of you hypocrites, as it is written, the people honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Howbeit in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. For laying aside the commandment of God, you hold the tradition of men, as the washing of pots and cups and many other such like things you do. And he said unto them, full well ye reject the commandment of God, that ye may keep your own tradition. Verse 13. You can, you know, stick whatever metaphor in there you want, or for the pots and the cups and so on and so forth. He said, you got your stuff, your religious kind of stuff that you do that separates people from God, including yourself. Making the word of God of none effect through your tradition, which ye have delivered, and many such like things do ye. I'm telling you, I'm just saying, don't be depressed and bummed out about this. I'm just saying, this is what we've done. Now, our experience of Jesus is limited by the limits that we put on Jesus. If you don't believe that, then go to a church where they don't believe in healing. I promise you, people don't get healed in that church. Why? Because they've limited God with what they believe about God.
Come on.
Well, we could point our finger at them, but the truth is every one of us do it to some degree.
Exactly.
And most of these are unconscious things, but sometimes it's intentional. And of course, there's a trainload of religious context and teachings that cause us to be this way. Here's a revelation for you. You're going to find Jesus pretty much as you expect to find him.
There you go.
Not because he's exactly what you expect him to be, but because you insist that he be what you expect him to be. That's called religion. What do you think of Jesus? Let me ask it this way. What do you think he thinks of you?
Buddy.
That's right. But most of our thinking is based on religion. In John 14:9, I won't have you go there for the sake of time. John 14:9 is just simply Jesus said, have I been so long time with you and you still don't know me? If you see me, you've seen the Father. Imagine living your entire life in a world where the people that were closest to you don't get you. Oh, you do. And Jesus understands. Jesus loves life. How could the joy of the Lord be our strength if the Lord isn't full of joy? We read in Mark how religion can be deceived into rejecting Jesus and rejecting people. If you read the Gospels without bias, without a religious bias, religion is the enemy, or at least in the hands of the enemy. That's what Jesus was talking about. Wasn't the religion that he sent wasn't from God, but it ended up in the wrong hands. Or the hands that it ended up in were manipulated by the enemy. Let's don't be arrogant and think, well, that could only happen 2,000 years ago. Are you kidding?
Come on.
We're still human, and the devil's still the devil.
Right.
And he's still trying to deceive humanity into seeing a distorted image of what God's like and who God is.
Come on.
See, I'm going to skip my scriptures here. You can... if you want to look them up, there's plenty of them in there. But it's hot. The hostility that Jesus always had was with the religious people.
Right.
See, religion uses, you know, sanctified words and activities and things that look and sound real churchy, regardless of what the denomination is.
Right.
Now, everybody does it. They just got their own little way of doing it, their own little thing.
Right.
So we see, we come out of the Pentecostal movement, which was very, you know, there was spiritual gifts and so forth operating there, and as well there it should have been, and still are to this day. But then the charismatic movement comes along with some revelation that God's not quite as angry as everybody thought, and that there's a little more freedom in loving God and serving God than we expected, but they got their own little show. They got some revelation, but they got their little act put into it too. And why? Because that's what people do. Because
yeah.
I go back and I try to find a lot of the things that we did in Pentecost. I try to find the things that we see in charismatic circles and other groups. It's not there. I'm sorry. You can give me all the talk you want to about it, but it's not in there. Jesus operated simply by the Spirit as a human being with a personality, and then he just related to other human beings and he interacted with them as a human being. Not like he was, I mean, God, if anybody was going to act, you know, really spiritual, you would have thought it would be him, wouldn't it?
Right.
But he doesn't. He acts just like a guy.
Yeah.
A guy you work with. A woman, you know, that lives across the backyard from you.
Yeah.
Another person. With some information and some revelation about how God loves them and cares about them and wants to do good to them and for them.
Yes.
Jesus even did the same thing that would be good for all of us to think about as well. He said, it's not me doing this, it's the Father. He wasn't trying to draw attention to himself. He said, it's the Father that's in me. He's doing the work. Well, if it was the Father that was in him doing the work, then it's the Father that's in you that's doing the work, and nobody can take precedence over this thing.
Yeah.
Nobody can say, I have this, or they can say they have it, but they can't deny that you have it.
Right.
They can deny whether or not you're operating in it, but they can't deny whether you have it, not if you're a believer.
Exactly.
That's why Jesus said, and greater than these, greater signs than these shall you do if you believe, not if you belong to the right group. Praise God. And all of that does is distort the image of God and pervert the way he wants to interact with human beings. There's Christianity, and then there's Christian culture. And we confuse the two. Like I said, Christian culture is depends on where you go. Might be big hair one place, little tight buns, little long hair hanging down. Might be no hair. Praise the Lord. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. I'm just saying that's a culture. It's not necessarily Christianity. It's just a Christian culture.
Come on.
I mean, you couldn't wear short-sleeved shirts. We live in one of the hottest places in Texas,
yeah.
Most humid. And I was a sinner because I wore a short-sleeved shirt sometimes because I was out wading through the swamps and the bogs reading water meters.
Yeah.
And it was... My pastor even told me. They were out fishing one time, and another pastor was with him, and he had his sleeves rolled up like two, you know, you fold your long sleeve shirt up a couple of folds, and they were out there fishing. It's hot. They're out in the middle of a lake. The sun's beating down on them. Water, the heat reflecting back up off the water, and this pastor, he said, he kept looking at me out of the corner of his eye, and he said, finally, he just couldn't stand it anymore, and the guy reached over and pushed his sleeve up to see how far the tan line went. Now, you say that's ridiculous. I just say that's religion.
Amen.
I lived it. I seen it.
Yep.
I experienced it. Does that make them all bad people? No, but they are deceived about what God wants and how God wants to interact with us and relate to us.
Amen.
And I'm saying, okay, we can laugh about that, but then I look at other things that I see are just as weird.
Yep.
But because, you know, we do it. We think it must be right. I'm not saying you're going to hell because you do it or you don't do it. I'm just saying if it's drawing more attention to you than it is to Jesus, then it ain't of God. That's all there is to it. I don't, you know, I just don't care. That's just the truth. It focuses on individuals instead of on God. You have like, you know, big Broadway-like services, flashing lights and smoke and vapor and huh? I mean, is it wrong? No, I'm not saying it's wrong, but I'm saying somebody walks in and thinks this is what God's into.
Yeah.
You see, like, a Broadway producer? He's as real in a tent, in a backyard, in a cave, as he is anywhere.
Yes.
In your own car.
Yes.
Going down the highway. He's there. Praise the Lord. Things we say, like being drunk in the spirit. Again, I know people are going to misunderstand me. I'm not saying you can't use this kind of language amongst ourselves. We know what we're talking about when we say that. But you don't say that to some person out on the street. They don't have a clue what you're talking about. And you just sound weird. And it makes God sound weird. Soaking in the word. Did you get the blessing? Having quiet time. And on and on and on and on. I could say all kinds of things. I could defend everybody in here if I wanted to. Praise the Lord. But I'm saying loving the culture of the church is not loving Jesus. Pharisees love their religious culture. Long prayer robes, long phylacteries and their hair curls and the honor for being the clergy. But they hated Jesus. And I'm just going to tell you, a wingnut talking about Jesus is worse than 10 atheists. Because he's claiming that he knows something that he really doesn't know. We're not Pentecostal people. We're not charismatic people. We're Jesus people. Let me, you know, Jesus said, and I'm going to close with this. But Jesus said that there was a, he said to any teacher, any rabbi, any scribe, he said that teaches like he's supposed to teach will show you old things and new things. Mm-hmm. And it flipped them out when he did that. But people loved to be with Jesus. Yeah. Just to be with him. Yeah. You can't take your church culture and language and drop it in the middle of a bar or a fishing trip. Then it's not from Jesus, because that's exactly what he did. You can talk about sunshine and be blind. You can talk about the ocean and never get past the beach. Doesn't mean you know anything about it. And a lot of what's taught about Jesus is by people who just don't know him that well. And I just challenge you to, can you do something different in church? Are you afraid to get up and lay hands on somebody in the church service and pray for them? Prophesy to them? Right? How about take a case of wine to a wedding the next time? Yeah, well, I know. But I'm just saying, we need to think differently about him, and we need to think differently about us. When Jesus made that remark about the scribe, any good scribe that's teaching old things, new things, he was shaking up his listeners. They were getting freaked. They were getting angry. Some of them were mad. Some of them were just diminishing him. He's nobody. He's nothing. The others were just downright angry and wanted to kill him. Because he was messing with their cherished assumptions about God while he was inviting them into a very new way understanding God. And if you want to know some new things, how about reevaluating the way we know God, the way we think how God wants to interact with us and through us to other people? That would be a new thing. Because the veil was coming down, and it was coming down forever. They could be angry or they could be dismissive. It didn't really matter. But in that one sentence parable, he offers these people rescue from their religion to God. And he offers us the same rescue. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. It's our image that keeps fluctuating and varying. Let me ask you a question. And this is, I'm closing right here. What are you looking forward to with Jesus? Let him be himself with you, and you be yourself with him. And you'll find out all kinds of doors will open in that relationship. Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Give the Lord a hand clap this morning. Praise God. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Father, thank you for the food that we're about to receive. Thank you for the hands that prepared it. And thank you for being you, Lord. And thank you for making us who we are. Thank you for coming and interacting with us and accepting us in the beloved. Thank you for sharing your personality and your love and your goodness and your kindness with us, and help us to share that with others even as you shared it. Now bless this food and the people that are about to partake of it. It's a time of fellowship where you are exalted and we are made safe and at peace ourselves in the arms of our loving God. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Last one down gets the jalapenos. Praise the Lord.